If a local celebrity was to invite you to come and sit with them, you would consider that a great honor. Now, can you imagine God Himself calling Jesus up to heaven, saying to Jesus, "Come and sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool"? That is a great honor. The honor that God has honored Jesus with is the same honor that God has for you, if only you will accept it. God called Jesus to heaven and set Jesus at his right hand, and that's exactly what God has in mind for you. The relationship that God has with Jesus, it's a very close relationship. The Father loves the Son loves the Father. The Father and the Son are both one, and that's exactly the kind of relationship that God has for you. The relationship that God wants for you and with you is a relationship in which God is the Father. He has no other relationship for you except the fatherly relationship, except the relationship where He is the Father. And we see that because when mankind fell, when sin came into mankind, when sin came into the human race, God did not send anyone but His only begotten Son, because the relationship that was lost was a father, listen, was a father and son relationship. That's the reason why God sent His Son, because Adam and Eve had a relationship with God, and in this relationship, God was the Father. So when the relationship fell apart, God had to send Jesus, His Son, to restore the other sons and daughters of God back to fellowship with Him. And Jesus did this by the shedding of the blood. He gave up His own life. He laid His life down for you. If you've never been told before, if you've never been advised or encouraged, if you've never been informed about this, today is the day you have to hear this, that Jesus died for you. And when Jesus Christ went to that cross, as Jesus was hanging on the cross, God was in Jesus Christ reconciling the world to Himself. God has nothing but love for you. God loves you so much. And this is why Jesus came. You good?
Nah, I'm okay.
God's got nothing but love for you. The relationship that He has for you is the relationship where He is the Father, and that's what God wants for you. You see, the reason why God sent His Son, Jesus Christ, is because the relationship that Adam and Eve lost in the Garden of Eden was the relationship where God was the Father. That's the reason why God sent His Son, to restore the other sons. Praise the Lord. And amen. So I plead the blood of Jesus into the very foundations of the town of Odom, because it's never God's desire or intention that any of us should perish, but that we should come to the knowledge of the truth. The truth is a person. The person has a name, and His name is Jesus Christ. Jesus is the way, Jesus is the truth, Jesus is the life, and no one goes to the Father except by the blood of Jesus. So I speak the blood of Jesus Christ into the very foundation of the town of Odom. I speak the blood of Christ into the heavens and the atmosphere above Odom, for the pulling down of principalities and powers, for the pulling down of thrones and dominions, for the pulling down of spiritual wickedness in the heavenly places, for the pulling down of the rulers of the darkness of this world, and for the pulling down of demonic strongholds in Jesus' name. I use the blood of Jesus to remove from the minds of the people of Odom any misconception about the gospel. I use the blood of Jesus to remove from the minds of the people of Odom the blindfold of darkness, the blindfold of not knowing who Jesus is. I speak the blood of Jesus into the soul and spirit of the people of Odom, because the hour has come for those who are spiritually dead to be made alive by the hearing of the voice of the Son of God. I speak the blood of Jesus into every household in order for the peace of God to rule and reign in every home in order. They say that because of the lockdown, domestic violence went up, but I speak the blood of Jesus. I speak the blood of Jesus Christ, and I use the voice of the blood of Jesus to calm the storm of domestic violence in the homes of the people of Odom. There was a time when Jesus Christ was traveling with his disciples. He was in a boat, and the word of God says that Jesus was asleep, and there was a great tempest, in so much that the boat was covered with the waves. And the disciples came to Jesus and said, "Master, save us, we perished." And Jesus said to them, "How is it that you're so fearful, O ye of little faith?" Then Jesus arose, commanded the storm. He said, "Peace, be still," and the storm calmed down. And by the very same voice of the blood of Jesus, we calm down the spirit of domestic violence in the homes of the people of Odom in the name of Jesus. And I know a lot of people struggle to just attain peace and quiet, to just have a single day where there's peace and quiet in the home. It's difficult for some people, but I speak the blood of Jesus, because the blood of Jesus Christ carries the very life of God, because Jesus is the Son of the living God. Jesus is the Son of God. When Jesus was baptized, what does the scripture say? The Bible says that the heavens were opened and Jesus saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And a voice was heard from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." So we have it on record that God called Jesus his Son. And when Jesus was crucified, as soon as the cross went up, the first thing that Jesus said was, "Father, forgive them, they know not what they do." If you missed it, Jesus calls God Father, and he says, "Forgive them." But he did call God his Father. So at baptism, God is calling Jesus his Son, and at crucifixion, Jesus is calling God his Father. These two obviously know each other. These two are acknowledging, accepting, and receiving each other. So who am I to say that Jesus is not the Son of God? And who are you to say that Jesus is not the Son of God? When God himself from his very own mouth says that Jesus is his Son, and Jesus at crucifixion says that God is his Father. If I meet you, you're walking with your son, I stop you too, and I say to your son, "Do you know this man?" And your son says, "Yes, he's my dad." And then I say to you, "Do you know this kid?" And you say, "Yes, this one is my son." It doesn't really matter what I think. This is for you, a father and son. It doesn't really matter what my opinion is. It doesn't really matter what I think and what I believe. As long as you two are calling each other father and son, then we know that you are father and son. You say that you are made in the image of God, right? You say that you're made in the image of God, right? And you know, sometimes we have really bad days as people. We have really bad days either at work, someone is bullying us, or the manager is just being a pain, or things are not really going well, or we're not making any profit, we're not making any money, or maybe we're even being threatened by, with being sacked. And you're just having a terrible, terrible, terrible day. The day is not really going well for you. But the moment you come into your house and start playing with your son or your daughter, the moment you come into your house and you start playing with your kid, you forget about the bad day that you've had. Because you're just playing with your son. And your son brings you so much joy. And your son or your daughter brings you so much joy. And you forget that you've had a bad day at work. The moment you come into your house and you see your kid running to you wanting to play with dad. So if you are made in the image of God and you enjoy playing with your son or your daughter, believe you me, God enjoys the company of his own son, Jesus Christ. Believe you me. God enjoys the company of his son, Jesus. God calls Jesus. Jesus, his son. Jesus calls God his father. These two obviously know each other. So who are we to say otherwise? We have no right whatsoever to dispute it. You know, we have no right whatsoever to dispute it, because these two obviously know each other. God calls Jesus, "This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased." And Jesus says, "My Father and I are one." And Jesus says, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." You see that these two already know each other. These two know each other and they are acknowledging each other. God calls Jesus his son. Jesus is calling God his father. And that settles that. That settles it. So the reason why Jesus came, and the reason why God sent Christ Jesus as his son, is because, you know, when a father gets home and he sees one of the children missing, he's not going to go to the next door neighbor and say, "Have you seen my kid?" If you have four sons in your house, you have four sons in your house, and you get home and three of your sons are missing, there's only one. What are you going to do? You are going to send that one son. And that's what God did with Jesus. You and I were missing as the sons of God. But God sent Jesus. You're good, you're good. But God sent Jesus as this firstborn son of God. And he came looking for you and me. If you come into your house and you've got four sons and three of your sons are missing, are you going to go to the next door neighbor to say, "Where is my son?" and ask about where your sons are? Obviously not. You're going to ask the firstborn, and that's what God did with Jesus. Jesus is the firstborn son of God. We are the adopted children of God by the blood of Jesus. So when we went missing, what did God do? He sent his son Jesus, and Jesus came looking for you. I repeat the question. If you have four sons in your house and three of your sons are missing, what do you do? Do you go to the next door neighbor to ask about your missing sons, or do you go to the one who's remained in the house? If you say to your children, "Listen, I'm going out for a while. I don't want anyone going anywhere. When I come back, I want to find you here in this house." And you go about your business. You know you've told your sons to remain and stay where they should stay. But three of your sons leave the house. And you return home to find one son in the house. What are you going to do? Obviously, you're going to tend to the son who's remained in the house and say to the son who's remained in the house, "Where are your brothers? Where are your brothers?" And the one who's remained in the house will tell you where the brothers are. If they've gone to the shops, he will say, "Oh, they've gone to the shops." If they've gone to the park to play, the one who's remained in the house will say to you, "Oh yes, they've gone to the park to play." If they've gone to the library, the one who's remained in the house will say to you, "They've gone to the library." And your dad will send that one son who's remained in the house, "Go get your brothers. Go get your brothers." That's what a father will do. If you tell your sons to stay in the house and all of them but one remains and go wherever they go, when you come back home and you find that your sons are not in the house, what are you going to do? Obviously, you're going to say to the one who's remained in the house, "Go and find your brothers. Go and find your brothers." That's what you do. When your sons are missing in the house, the one who's remained in the house is the one you send to go and look for the brothers. And this is what God did with Jesus. When the entire human race, when the human race straight away came up out of the house of God through the deception of Satan, God says to Jesus, "Where are your brothers? and God said to Jesus, go and find your brothers. Did you know that Jesus is not ashamed to call you your brother? Did you know that there's nothing that pleases God even more to have a family relationship with you? Do you know that God is waiting for family reunion with you? Did you know that God is waiting for family reconciliation with you? Did you know that the reason why God made you for a relationship with Him so you could enjoy His love? That's why God made you. You see, there's a place in your soul, there's a place in your spirit that will never get satisfied until you come to God through Jesus Christ. Because Jesus is the only way you can get through to God. And why do I say this boldly and confidently? Because Jesus died and rose again. The resurrection of Jesus from the dead is God's stamp of approval to show you and I that Jesus is the one sent from God. You know, because if you are coming from God, if you say that God sent you, then you should have the life of God in you. So Jesus demonstrated that He has the life of God in Him by being risen from the dead. The resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead is evidence that God has made contact with you. And for you to make contact with the true and the living God, you do it by the same person, Jesus. If you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is the Son of God who died for you, He shed His blood for you to reconcile you to God through forgiveness of sin, you also become a child of God. If you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that God raised Jesus from the dead, God will bring back to life that relationship that died in the Garden of Eden. Did you know that you once had a relationship with God? That's why there's something about you that wonders about God. That's why sometimes when you're sitting down and no one is really listening to your thoughts, listening to how you're thinking, you begin to think about the things of God. Every single one of us, we think about God. Some of us think about God publicly, some of us think about God privately. But nevertheless, every single one of us, we think about God. We do. Every single one of us. It's because you once had a relationship with God in the Garden of Eden. The relationship died when God said to Adam and Eve, any tree in the Garden of Eden you are free to eat, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the day you eat of it, you will surely die. Adam and Eve ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and they died in the spirit. The death in the spirit was followed by physical death. Did you know that God is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? God is three in one. And you're also made in the image of God. So you are spirit, soul, and body. You are three in one because God is three in one. With your physical body, you are aware of the surroundings. With your soul, you are aware of yourself, self-consciousness, self-awareness. And with your spirit man, you are supposed to be aware of God. But the spirit man died in the Garden of Eden. The spirit man died in the Garden of Eden, and this is why people find it difficult to hear God. This is why people find it difficult to connect with God. This is why people find it difficult to have a relationship with God, because the spirit man died in the Garden of Eden. So Jesus came, died on the cross, He shed His blood for you and me. And after shedding His blood, they put Him in the grave. And after putting Jesus in the grave, He was in the grave for 3 days. And on the third day, Jesus rose from the dead. Jesus rose from the dead. Have you ever noticed that come Easter, even the atheist will take Easter holiday. Even the unbeliever will take Easter holiday. Even those that don't want anything to do with Jesus, they take Easter holiday. And what do you think Easter is all about? Easter is when the world comes to a standstill and everyone acknowledges that Jesus is the real deal. And everyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, because the life that God has never dies. God's life is eternal. God's life is everlasting. That's why Jesus rose from the dead. That's why Jesus defeated the power of the grave. That's why Jesus annihilated the power of death. Did you know that the fear of death is the only one thing that Satan uses against humanity? This is the only thing that Satan has as an advantage over the sons and the daughters of Adam. You know, the guilt of sin, the fear of death, and the fear of hell. That's the only thing that Satan can use against you. That's the only thing that Satan has going for him against you. The guilt of sin, the fear of death, and the fear of hell. That's the only thing that the devil can torment you with. He's got nothing else. So the moment you come to the cross of Jesus, and you are washed in the blood of Jesus, and you are born again, and you are reconciled with God, and you have peace with God, the devil has nothing, absolutely nothing over you. Substance abuse. Where do you think that comes from? That comes from the devil. That comes from Satan. And Satan is not a figment of your imagination. Satan is a real person who hates human beings because human beings are created in the image of God. Anytime the devil looks at you, he sees the image of God. And this is why Satan hates people. You see the violence and all the aggression in the world. Where do you think that comes from? That comes from Satan. Prejudice and racism. That comes from Satan. When a kid takes a knife and sticks another kid to death, where do you think that's coming from? Because when God made humanity, He made a loving humanity. God is love, and in Him is no hatred at all. We are made in the image and the likeness of God. So if we are made in the image and the likeness of God, it means that when God made us, He made us as a loving humanity. He made us as a loving human race. Hatred came into the world because of Satan. And if you have any hatred in your heart against anyone, that comes from Satan. But the blood of Jesus was shed for you. So I speak the blood of Jesus to the very foundations of the town of Odom. Because it's not the will of God that any should perish. God has never intended for anyone to die a sinner's death. And it's not God's intention that anyone should go to a sinner's hell. And this is where the blood of Jesus Christ was shed for you. And this is why Jesus was risen from the dead for you. Speak the blood of Jesus Christ into the atmosphere above Odom, for the pulling down of thrones and dominions, for the pulling down of principalities and powers, for the pulling down of spiritual wickedness in the heavenly places, for the pulling down of the rulers of the darkness of this world, for the pulling down of demonic strongholds in the minds of the people of Odom, for the removing, oh God, of the veil over the minds of the people of Odom, for the glorious light of the glorious gospel of the glorious Jesus Christ, the Son of the glorious God, to shine in the heart and soul of the people of Odom. I speak the blood of Jesus into the heart and soul of the people of Odom, because the hour has come for the dead to hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear the voice of the Son of God shall live again. I speak the blood of Jesus into every house in Odom, for the peace of God to rule and reign in every home in Odom. In the name of the Son of God, Jesus Christ, amen and amen. Praise the Lord.